What is a thread? Before we can talk about a thread, we have to understand a process. A process is an instance of an executing program. At its core, a process is essentially a blob of memory. It has code that needs to be executed. It has data, such as variables. It has a register and a stack to keep track of the order of execution. The code is going to be compiled into instructions that can run on our CPU. So here's an example of a program in C. When we compile this, it's going to turn into instructions that are going to look a little bit like this. As it runs, instructions are pulled off of memory and executed on the CPU. There are two really important parts of a process. There is a program counter. The program counter keeps track of where the process is currently executing. Imagine the program counter like an arrow pointing at an instruction set. As the program runs, this location is kept by the hardware on a register on the CPU. When the program pauses or is preempted by another program, we have to store that counter somewhere. There's also a thing called the stack. This keeps track of the depth of our program. As we're executing here, we will eventually call this increment function, and the current context is added onto the stack. As the increment function is called, it will eventually have to return. And whenever we return, where does it go? The program looks on the stack and see where we were currently executing and uses that to determine where to resume execution. Also, a special thanks to Julia Evans. You can find this code and this example on her blog, jvns.ca, as well as a really good blog post describing what exactly stacks are and how they're implemented. Thank you. At this point, we've got roughly everything we need to start and stop a program, including the program counter and the stack pointer. We need a way to store all of this data, and so it goes into a struct in the operating system called the process control block, or PCB. This includes process state, process number, program counter, registers, memory limits, list of open files, signal mask, and CPU scheduling information, in addition to some other things. Also, a fun fact, since a process is entirely described by a PCB, whenever we want to fork a process, essentially all we have to do is copy a parent process control block to a child process control block. So I thought that was kind of interesting. So a process can do pretty much two types of tasks. The first type of task is a CPU-bound task, when the program is running and spending the majority of its time actually executing code. An example would be processing data or calculating prime numbers. The second type of a task a process can do is called an I/O task. An example of an I/O task would be reading from a file from disk, or making a database call, or making a network call, for example, to the Heroku API. As you can guess from my use of emojis here, that whenever we're doing an I/O heavy task, the process doesn't do much. It makes the request, and then it just sits there and waits for data to come back so that it can wake up and start doing work again. This matters because we pay for our CPU time, and we don't want our program to not be doing anything, or we don't want it to just be sitting there sleeping and waiting on data. And so we want to maximize our CPU utilization. So how exactly do we do that? If we have one CPU heavy process, and one CPU, then we're set. The CPU is working at maximum speed. But what happens when we start to see I/O? In this example, our program is just sitting there and sleeping. Our CPU is sitting there and sleeping for a third of the time, and we're no longer using our CPU efficiently. Well, we can fix this by adding an additional process. So in this example, while one of our process is sleeping, the other process is running. So aside from the context switch, we are pretty much using our CPU 100% of the time. All right, so what are the pros? Whenever we're using multiple processes to utilize our CPU, then, well, we get better CPU utilization. So that's good. What are the cons? Unfortunately, to do this, we need a lot of processes. And those processes take up memory, which is a finite resource. And loading and unloading a PCB is expensive. Sharing data between processes is also hard. You can do things like map memory to different processes, as well as sharing data via sockets. And in general, it's kind of so difficult that most people don't really do it. Wouldn't it be cool if there's some kind of really lightweight process that uses less memory, something with smaller time to context switch? Well, we have it. It's called threads. So previously, we looked at a process, and this is everything we need to run a program. With a thread, we can share code, and we can also share data. Really, with a thread, all we need is a new stack and a new register. So this is kind of an example of what a single-threaded process would look like. It's a process, and inside of it, we have a thread. And that thread has a register and a stack. And if we want to have multiple threads on our process, then we don't have to duplicate that code or the data. We just need new registers and new stacks for each of our threads. All right, so what are the pros of using multiple threads? Well, like before, we get much better CPU utilization. Unlike before, we can reuse existing process memory, which means that we don't have to duplicate that code and we don't have to duplicate that data. And it means that we're not going to run out of memory, or at least not nearly as fast. It also means that we have a smaller context switch time between the different threads, as opposed to having to context switch between different processes, just because it's more lightweight. We can also reuse cache values, such as memory lookups. All right, now there has to be a downside to this, and the downside actually kind of looks a lot like the upside. Shared code and shared data inside of our thread does make things faster, and it does make things more lightweight. Unfortunately, it means it's also much harder to work with. Now we have to consider how will other threads be accessing our data, and we have to introduce new constructs like mutexes and other forms of synchronization and condition variables. So the core value add of threads is having that share code. That's basically all a thread is just a process with share code. But unfortunately, by doing that, we also add a lot of complexities. So hopefully today you have better understood exactly what a thread is, and it's not as mythical and not as difficult to understand. And unfortunately, you've also understood maybe a little bit about why exactly threads are difficult to use and why they're hard, but also why we can't necessarily make them any easier. Thank you very much for joining me.